Greetings, brethren. Happy feast. Once again, we are celebrating the happiest festival of God's church, the Feast of Tabernacles. But chances are, once we are in revelry and in a state of euphoria, our understanding of the purpose of keeping the feast is sometimes obscured. It is therefore my purpose today to remind you of the meaning and purpose of this festival, that we are but pilgrims and strangers of this world. There are various names in the Bible by which this feast is called. Feast of Tabernacles, Leviticus 23:34. Feast of Ingathering, Exodus 23:16. Feast of Booth, Exodus 34:22. The NIV Compact Dictionary of the Bible defines tabernacle as a portable sanctuary that embodied all that are necessary for the worship of the Lord under nomadic conditions, and also served as a prototype of a subsequent permanent building. Unquote. This definition of a portable sanctuary under the body conditions signifies a sense of temporariness. In Old Testament times, the tabernacle has to be moved from place to place, from time to time. It suited perfectly with the nomadic way of life of ancient Israel in the wilderness. Nomads, as we all know, are wanderers, people without a permanent habitation, where they normally dwell on tents or booth. Hence, the Feast of Tabernacles is also called the Feast of Booth. According to Easton's Topical Bible, a booth is a hut made of branches of a tree. On the other hand, the name's Topical Bible is even more explicit, as it calls it a temporary hut. This description exactly drives home the point. It is but a temporary dwelling, not the typical bahay kubo in Tagalog, but simply a kubo-kubuan. Thus, the Feast of Tabernacle or Feast of Booth then is a feast of temporary dwellings. This all indicates that we are just sojourners or pilgrims of this life. We are but passers-by in this world. In fact, the psalmist says, and I quote, "I used to go with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise, the multitude that keep a pilgrim feast," unquote. Psalms 42:4. That's in New King James only. Take note that the psalmist referred to the Feast of Tabernacles as a pilgrim feast. Pilgrims, as we all know, are travelers, wayfarers, or sojourners. As long as they are pilgrims, they don't have a permanent residence. They are on the move towards a particular destination. Brethren, that's exactly what we do when we keep the feast. Except during this COVID-19 pandemic, we normally travel to the location or feast site God, through His ministry, has designated and placed His name. That's in Deuteronomy 14:23-25. True Christians are pilgrims wending their way to appear before God, to be with God. When you stop to think about it, that's exactly what life is all about for God's people. The Christian life is a journey with a destination. Just as the children of Israel wandered through the wilderness, living on temporary dwellings before reaching the promised land, we are making our way to the eternal inheritance that have been promised to us by God. We live in temporary dwellings in this life. Our home is temporary, so are our physical bodies being mortal. The Feast of Tabernacles or Feast of Temporary Abodes calls attention to the fact that our physical existence is temporary, that we are but pilgrims on our way to our awesome destination, the Kingdom of God. In fact, the Apostle Peter referred to the scattered Christians as pilgrim of the dispersion. 1 Peter 1:1. He stressed to the brethren that they were sojourners and pilgrims. 1 Peter 2:11. exhorted them to conduct themselves uprightly throughout the time of their sojourning here on earth, in fear, that is, in reverential fear. The patriarch Abraham, for instance, sojourned in the land of promise as in a foreign country. Hebrews 11 verse 9. Yes, wealth and position he had, but he did not set his heart on it. He was not all wrapped up in ever trying to acquire additional material positions and physical riches here and now. He knew his life was temporary. He looked to the future. He looked forward to the city whose builder and maker is God, the new Jerusalem. The faithful heroes of faith in Hebrews 11 all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Hebrews 11 verse 13. How about you, brethren? Do you belong to the world? Do material pursuits take up the choicest part of your time? Is your attention mostly centered on earthly things? Do your highest goals and aspirations revolve around the attainment of wealth, physical security, and comfort? Or are you a stranger and sojourner in the sinewy world, just passing through on your way to the kingdom of God? Brethren, we as Christians are looking forward to something permanent. We are waiting for the city whose maker and builder is God. Let us set our sight on the city prepared by God. Let us all realize that this temporary life is just the preliminary, the first step in the awesome human destiny. Living in temporary dwellings at the Feast of Tabernacles celebrates the great truth that in Christ's millennial reign, we will no longer be dwelling in temporary tabernacle of flesh. This physical tent, our mortal bodies, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. We will exchange them for permanent dwellings, eternal life. For according to the Apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1-4, we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved or destroyed, we have a building of God, an house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we are in this tabernacle, do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that immortality might be swallowed up by eternal life. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1-4. In closing, let me remind you, brethren, that we must set our heart on these pilgrimages, passing through the world, being sojourners with no permanent inheritance here. The values, the ideals, the customs, the styles, the philosophy and religion, the entertainment and glamour of this world should not dominate our lives. Life is a pilgrimage. Let us use what precious time is left to learn God's ways and have them written in our hearts. For now, our salvation is nearer than we first believed. Brethren, happy feast. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Looks like we're really going to have a feast here from the looks of things. I have a sermon pertinent to this day, but before I give you that sermon, I have another sermon. I guess you could call it a sermon. I want to talk a little bit about the things that are so obvious to us of late in the news. It's pretty much unavoidable in light of the timing. And I think we can see the irony of all the stuff that's going on in the Middle East with the timing associated, not only with 9/11, when all of that violence over there started, which wasn't by accident, but the timing, of course, in the Middle East in association with the Feast of Trumpets, because we know that it's the events that are going to happen in that part of the world that are eventually going to set in motion a number of events, of course, that the Bible talks about. It's called eschatology, the study of the end time, and it's going to result in the Lord Jesus Christ returning to this planet. So the timing is very ironic, to say the least. And we're very much aware of what that's going to portend over there for Jerusalem, for the Jewish state, things that are going to happen. We're very familiar. I'll just paraphrase for the time's sake, for the most part, scriptures that we're familiar with. But we know that the book of Zechariah and other prophecies make it very clear that before the kingdom of God gets here, a whole lot of ugly, unpleasant stuff must happen. And I think those of us who are students of the Bible who have heard many prophetic sermons over the years and who have studied God's word in that regard are certainly experiencing some trepidation Is that a fair statement in regards to what we see on the horizon, the things that we see going on, the increase in violence over there, the madness that we see going on over there? And unfortunately, a bunch of thugs, a bunch of Arab Muslim murderers attacked our embassy in Benghazi and also, of course, in Egypt as well, in Cairo. And it seems that virtually all of our embassies in the Islamic world, in every Islamic nation, has been under assault and attack. It remains to be seen whether that'll ramp up to the level of what happened in Benghazi. But the fact is, four people were murdered. You know, there's been millions of dollars of damage to U.S. property, which is considered sovereign property, by the way. All embassies, the diplomatic corps has set that up in such a way that embassies, be it ours or any other nation, is considered the sovereign property of that nation. When you go in those past those walls in Benghazi or wherever it might be, theoretically, you're just as much on American soil as we are right now. So there are many aspects to this from a geopolitical nature, of course, and we know that a lot of this stuff is contrived by Muslim jihadist terrorists to coincide with not only with what they allege to be Jewish holy days, but anniversaries of their own significant events and attacks against the world of the infidels. It was not by chance that happened on 9/11. The entire history of Islam, going all the way back to Mohammed, shows very clearly that they repeat over and over and over again anniversaries and significant events in their own history. So for those who think that it was just by chance that it happened on 9/11, no, it wasn't. That's always a consistent behavior in the Muslim world in the execution of what they refer to as jihad, our holy work to further the cause of Muhammad and Islam. Four Americans were killed, including our Ambassador Stevens, and what you don't know about that, probably, although some of you may have heard the newscast, it was only on once. It's been whitewashed, it's been pulled, and I think our government is trying to make sure that American outrage doesn't reach a level that would force them to do something that they don't want to do. But it was reported, and then the reports have been pulled, that not only was Ambassador Stevens murdered, of course, but that his corpse was abused in various ways, and that he was sodomized prior to his death. Of course, these are just peaceful people who want to get along with their fellow human beings, right? The reality is, we live in a world that's fast deteriorating, moving towards what this day represents. And the increase in violence and the lack of civility in this country, of course, is magnified abroad. And a lot of things are on the horizon. Are we not all very much concerned about what we see going on with the animosity, the growing animosity, the growing distance is perhaps a better word, between the United States State Department and that of the sovereign state of Israel over there in the Middle East? And we are causing them to be very much paranoid. And paranoia causes people to do things sometimes that, you know, it could lead to things we don't want to happen. And that's going to set the world on fire. It's just a matter of when. It's not if. It's a matter of timing. It's a matter of when it's going to happen. And the reality is, Bibi Netanyahu and the Jewish people are understandably nervous and worried and concerned. The Israeli people go to sleep every night. Within arm's reach of them are their gas masks. They have endless drills in the schools and hospitals and at work and in Israeli life every day for finding your particular bomb shelter, wherever it may be. And nowhere in the state of Israel, even at the border's widest points, And just for your information, there is a point in the state of Israel that can successfully cut Israel in two, where from border to ocean is only 8 miles. Now, you could walk across that in a very short amount of time, and a mechanized army, of course, would literally roll across it in minutes. And anywhere you are in the state of Israel, when the alarm goes off, and there are sirens and alarms that have been wired into that culture all over the place, but at any given moment, those alarms could go off, and if they detect them, and they have a sophisticated radar system, at any given moment, if one of those alarms go off, no one would have more than 30 seconds to reach some kind of shelter in that tiny little country. So you think their paranoia might be a little bit justified. They might be a little bit justified in worrying about whether or not Iran will indeed get a nuclear weapon. Let me tell you something. They will get a nuclear weapon, and we're not going to do anything to prevent it, and neither is anyone else. They're going to get it. They may already have it. And if they don't, they will acquire it. And that fits the scenario perfectly. I'm not so sure they'd necessarily use it, but boy, what a piece of blackmail that would be to try and bully your way around. And of course, if they did use it, just a nuclear weapon detonation the size of what we dropped on Hiroshima or Nagasaki, because of the dense population, all those people, there's 6 or 7 million Jews there, by some estimates 8 million, but there's a million Arabs in the mix there. But nevertheless, they'd die too. That's a very, very tight, compact population. They're all jammed together. And a bomb the size of Hiroshima would pretty well take care of the entire populace. They'd be exterminated. They couldn't survive even one of those. So, yes, they are very, very concerned. And being concerned, having some justifiable paranoia, it might cause them to act in a precipitous way to try and take out Iran. As a matter of fact, Mr. Netanyahu has said consistently, we will do that. And if you're not going to do it, we'll do it. And you know about the Samson strategy, what they call the Samson strategy? The Samson scenario, excuse me. In 1973, when they had the Yom Kippur War, Israel came very, very near losing. They were on the verge of being overrun. And it was only because of a massive, big time, the biggest airlift we've ever been involved in. A huge airlift of men and materials and weapons and so forth to Israel, and State Department efforts from our own government, warnings from our own government, bribes from our own government, billions of dollars promised all over the place to try and contain it, because the Egyptian or the Israeli Air Force rather was in the air. Planes were on the way to Cairo and Damascus and Baghdad and other places with nuclear weapons because they were that close to losing. And Ariel Sharon was in one of those planes. Ariel Sharon, you'll remember, was the former Prime Minister of Israel and former defense secretary of Israel as well, defense minister. He was in one of those planes. He was literally co-piloting one of those airplanes that was loaded with an atomic bomb on his way to Cairo. And he's the one who ultimately had to give the word, and they were called back. And they didn't obviously drop their bombs. But the planes were on the way with the bombs. And the scenario is, and Ariel Sharon is the one who spelled it out to the news, we will not go quietly away into the gas chambers again. We will not be pushed into the ocean. We will not be exterminated. You're not going to kill 6 million of us again. We, like Samson, when Samson was blinded and he prayed for the Lord to restore his strength, and he stood there between the pillars of the temple, and he pushed the temple down and killed all of his enemies. And the scripture says that in that instance, when he lost his own life, he killed more people in that instance than in his entire lifetime. And it's called the Samson scenario. We will not allow this to happen, and And it's kind of like blackmail. In other words, you better not let us get to this point, because Eero Sharon's word, verbatim quote, "We will pull the temple of humanity down with us when we go. We will detonate the bombs." That's the kind of scenario we're faced with. That's the reality. And I think we're dealing with it right now through rose-colored glasses, hoping that things will be different. And we need to face the realities. The realities that this book portends for us, and that the nightly news is making very clear as a possibility real soon. So it's important to remember and think about that, and to be praying about it. And it's understandable, of course, that the Jewish people who we are connected to by this book, as well as through genetics and culture, our only real ally in the Middle East, people who have the same values that we do, who consider life and death the same way we do, they are on the edge. They're on the knife's edge, you might say. So, having said that now, I think that sets the stage for what we know this day represents. The return of the Lord Jesus Christ at that critical moment when, if he did not return, no flesh would be saved alive. And I'll just reference that as a scripture I know you're familiar with in the book of Matthew, Luke, Mark. They all talk about that end time scenario. It's called the Olivet Prophecy that the Lord Jesus Christ gave. And he makes it clear, at some point, if he does not return, no flesh would be saved alive. So it's a very critical situation that we're faced with. I'm not prepared to stand up here today and tell you that you know, the end time is about to happen. You know, it's not going to happen tomorrow. It's not going to happen next week. But I think we are also erudite in some respects, not only about what this book says, but we've got some common sense, and we understand how quickly things can happen. And as I've reported before, and I like to use it as an illustration, you know, it's already been, 25 years now, about, or close to 25 years since the Soviet Union collapsed and came apart. It's amazing. Adolf Hitler was unknown in Germany, essentially. And he began to go around and give speeches. And he had an airplane. And he was the first person to ever do that. To get in an airplane and go somewhere and draw a crowd and get out and give a speech and then go somewhere else and do it again. He's the one who did. He was elected, you know. There was a lot of shenanigans going on behind the scenes, but he did indeed get the votes. He was a politician. Yeah. And he did that, came to power, rearmed Germany, plunged the world into war, caused 50 million deaths, and blew his own brains out all in the space of 12 years. So the point is, things can happen very, very quickly on a geopolitical level, obviously. And when you couple that with what we know about this book and the time of Jacob's trouble, that I think I could make a real good case for saying that we're easing right on into that time, you know. And I've always got a kick out of doing this because I enjoy the audience response. I'm not going to stand here and say we're in the time of Jacob's trouble, but brethren, tell me, is Jacob in trouble? You get the point. Yes. Is it the time? I don't know. We don't know everything. It is still called the mysterion of God, all of which has not been revealed. But we've been looking through that glass darkly for 2,000 years, and we're starting to see a lot of stuff in there pretty clear now, just as this book said we would be in the end time. So. All right, turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, brethren, over to Leviticus chapter 23, because I think we are indeed obliged to look at these scriptures on God's holy day. We're told to preach about them in their season. And so, to set the stage and be in compliance with God's word, that's what we will do. In Leviticus chapter 23, the Eternal spoke unto Moses, saying, "Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them concerning the appointments, the Moedim, the feasts of the Eternal, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are the feasts of the Jews." Is anybody following me? Doesn't say that, does it? Even these are the feasts of Israel. No, these are my feasts, saith the Eternal. You know, when something belongs to you and it's not appreciated by others, you can take that real personally. The Bible reveals that God does indeed have person. He has personality. He has likes and dislikes. He literally, once we meet our Father, we will realize He has a distinct personality that will be recognized by us, just like we all do. He's a being. He's real. He's not some nebulous nothing. He has a personality. And I think the Bible makes it clear He takes it personally when we don't follow what He has to say and we don't appreciate what He's given us. The holy days were given to God not so that He could enjoy watching us jump through hoops, do back over flips through hoops for His amusement, like some deity up on Mount Olympus. He gave them to us out of His love. He gave them to us because He thought them through. He imagined and came to certain conclusions about what can I do to get through the carnality of these beings made in my image? What can I do to have a mechanism whereby I can give inspiration to them that they cannot otherwise get? Ah, yes, I'll create the holy days. The holy days are mechanisms, teaching vehicles from God that can get through this gray matter in spectacular ways that nothing else can achieve. There is no other means of teaching, no other intellect on this planet, no library, no resource whatsoever more effective than the holy days. God's the one who invented them. Moses didn't invent them. And He gave them to us to teach us and to keep us connected to the truth. And it's because we cling to the holy days and won't let go of the holy days. We won't let go of the Sabbath. We continue to keep the holy days. Our imperfections in doing so notwithstanding, nevertheless, it's because we do that that we stay tied to the trunk of the tree of truth. And back many centuries ago, when Christendom abandoned the holy days and the Sabbath, it was a foregone conclusion that they ultimately would go totally and completely apostate and be completely and utterly heretical in all of their practices, and they are. And that's the religion that's extant in the world today in the name of Jesus Christ, and it's primarily because they abandoned the primary teaching vehicles that God has given us. His presence is in the Sabbath. His presence is in each of His holy days in ways that they're not in Wednesday or Monday or any other normal day. Now, you can worship God 24 hours a day, obviously, and He wants us to, 365 days a year. But there is a special connectivity with God in the Sabbath and the holy days. They are moedims. They are appointments. God expands energy. Something comes from God on each of the holy days. But in order to get it, you've got to keep the appointment. You have to keep the moedim. If you keep the moedim, the appointment, and that's literally what the word means. We have an appointment with God on the Sabbath and the holy days. If you keep the appointment, I've got something for you, but you cannot get it otherwise. It's special. It comes from me. It doesn't come from the accumulated philosophy of Israel. It doesn't come from man. It comes from my mind, from my being, from my spirit to you. In the Sabbath and the holy days, there's inspiration in our fellowship. There's inspiration in our preaching. And I've got it right now. I've got goosebumps all over me. There's inspiration. There's learning in God's Sabbath and holy days. These are my feasts. And He goes on to expound the fact that 6 days should be done and then the Sabbath. And He goes through the whole litany here. And over in verse 24, Leviticus chapter 3. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, you shall have Yom Teruah, a day of blowing of trumpets. In the seventh month, in the first day of the month, you shall have a Sabbath, a memorial, a bringing to memory of blowing of trumpets and holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein. You shall do no common work therein. But you shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Eternal. Well, we don't have to make a fire to the Eternal anymore because the Lord Jesus Christ took care of that. The sacrificial aspect of the Old Testament, the sacrificial aspect of the law in every detail, in every regard, the sin offering and all of the different offerings, all of the oblations and washings, every bit of that, every bit of the ritual that God gave ancient Israel is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. But the wisdom of the Old Testament, the wisdom of the Holy Days, the learning of the Holy Days, what they have for us, what they can do for us, that wasn't done away. That's why we're still obliged to keep them, because Christ fills it full for us, makes it meaningful for us, makes us understand what it's all about. Now, the idea that they could be done away, that the Sabbath or the Holy Days could be done away is preposterous on its face because they emanate from the very person of God. They can no more be done away than He can be done away. If you could do away with God, then you can do away with the Sabbath and the Holy Days because they emanate from the very person that He is, the being that He is. It's preposterous upon its face that anything that He's given us could change because He said, I change not. I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. Add not to it, nor diminish from it. It's very clear. And so, we've arrived at that point in time now where we are to keep this particular holy day. And this particular holy day, and in fact, all of the holy days. And let me frame this and portray this beginning with the Garden of Eden. Going all the way back in past eternity, we can prove from Scripture that the Holy Day concept already existed in the mind of God before human beings existed. Before man had ever sinned, God already knew they would sin, and the plan of salvation had already percolated in the mind of God. That's why the Scriptures that speak about Christ being crucified before the foundation of the world and from the foundation of the world and before the world was, makes it very clear that God already understood that a fail-safe would be necessary to accomplish what it was that He was trying to do, which we see in this specific purpose statement of God's Word, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And I want to turn to those Scriptures directly and share some things there from the Hebrew that I have not really talked with you about before, but we'll get to that. But the point is, the plan of salvation, what God is doing, we see the genesis of that in the book of Genesis, in the conversation that took place in the Garden of Eden, when God confronted the Nakash, Satan the devil. Now it's called a serpent in the Scripture, but let's be clear. In fact, just let me ask, does anyone here still labor under the belief that it was a snake having a conversation with Eve? It was not. The word serpent is a metaphor, of course. It's an analogous metaphor that God's Word uses over and over all through the Bible. We have them. And it portrays something for us that we can identify with. The word Nakash means a hissing, whispering, deceiver, and enchanter. In the right grammatical construct, it can also mean a bright and shining one. That doesn't fit the definition of a snake, does it? But a snake slithers in. It's very secretive. We come upon them and they startle us. And they're there and they hiss. And they are the symbol of evil in almost every culture that's ever existed on this planet, are they not? And they give us the creeps, don't they? Each and every one of them. Even now, it's like it's hardwired into us. And that's of course why the metaphor was used. That's why Moses portrayed it that way. And another reason, of course, being the fact that the word Satan as a personal name had not yet evolved in Moses' writings. And in fact, it does not appear in his writings as a personal name. And so the Nakash appeared to Eve. And we know the story. She was deceived. And what appeared to her, of course, is defined for us not so much in the account of the event itself, but in the New Testament, of course, we find out how Satan does indeed appear. What's the scripture teach us? That he appears as an angel of light. That's what appeared to her. She was not put off by talking with a creature of light, because she was used to that. God daily came down with his retinue and walked and talked with them in the garden. They were used to seeing that kind of being. They were used to that kind of supernatural interaction. They had it on a daily basis. So when this creature of light appeared to her, she was not put off by it. She was engaged in conversation with it. But she would have been just as shocked if a snake started talking to her as you or I would be. No. And so the Nakash deceived her. And as a result, we come on this scene here where God is now confronting what has happened. And he confronts Adam, he confronts Eve, and he confronts Satan, the Nakash, the snake. And the story is encapsulated by something that we know. Satan wants to be God over all of the angelic realm. And he is over one-third of them. But he wanted to be the king, the God, as it were, over all of them. What does the scripture teach us? I will exalt my throne above all of the stars. I will ascend above the heights, and I will be like the Most High. That was his goal. That was his ambition, and it still is. And so God tells him here in the garden, that's not going to happen. What's going to happen is you're going to be like a serpent. You know, you're caricaturized that way, and that fits, because you're going to be on your belly. Instead of being the highest of the high, you're going to be the lowest of the low all the days of your life, indicating there will be an end. And all the days of your life, you'll go on your belly. You're going to be lower than low. You're going to be beneath the feet of human beings. You're going to go on your belly. You're going to eat dirt. And that's the imagery there. But in this conversation, we see something very pertinent to this day. Because throughout the scripture, from cover to cover, one of the primary story themes of the Bible is the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's referred to, in most instances, as the day of the Lord, the coming day of the Lord. And there's more than 30 prophecies that deal with that in the Bible from cover to cover. That prophecy begins here in this conversation. And it ultimately will be a block of time and a specific day as well, because it will be a specific day during the day of the Lord when the Lord does indeed return. And so it is both, and the story begins right here. Satan the devil was there, Adam was there, his wife Eve was there, and so was the Eternal. And God said to the serpent, the Nakash, the enchanting deceiver, Satan the devil, he told him what the ultimate outcome of the story of man would be, as well as his own fate. God said, I will put enmity between you and man. I will put enmity. The word is ayiba in the Hebrew, and it literally means adversarial hostility. Competitive bitterness is another way to describe it. Adversarial hostility. You will be enemies. There will be hostility. Your relationship towards them will be adversarial. That is, you and man are and shall be enemies. What you produce and what she produces will be adversarial. Your seed, i.e. that which you produce, and her seed, that which she produces, which is characterized for us in the masculine gender when it speaks of his heel, obviously representing the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says, and I'm just paraphrasing, of course, maybe you've turned there already, that his heel would be bruised, but the Nakash's head would also be bruised. It's important to know what this word bruise translates as. Now think about this. Have you ever had a bruised heel or a bruise on your foot? It can be pretty painful. You know, I've had them before. You know, get like a planter's wart or different things that can happen. You step on a stone. I remember going barefoot when I was a little boy, and you step on a stone, you get a bruised heel, you know. It can be pretty painful, but it's certainly not life-threatening, and it heals pretty quickly, you know. That's the imagery we get here. Shuf is the word. Shuf is the Hebrew for bruise. And it can indeed mean a bruise of that nature, or it can mean something fatal, depending on the grammatical construction, depending upon the context and the way it's used, and the imagery that is portrayed for us. Now, a bruise to the heel, like I said, is not life-threatening. But a bruise, a shuf to the head, is translated no longer as a bruise when it occurs to the head. It is translated then as a crush or a break. And just think about it. What a perfect analogy it is. What a perfect metaphor we have here. If you step on the head of a serpent, any of you guys ever do that, or maybe some of you girls did that as a child? If ever crush a snake's head? I have. And I can assure you that it results in fatality to the mortality of the snake. And that's the imagery here. And he's telling this being, you're going to lose. And you're going to be destroyed. Either as a metaphor for what you stand for, what you represent, what you're trying to do, or a literal destruction. Now that's a subject for a theological discussion. I think most of my audiences know that I believe that it represents a complete and total destruction of the being, not just what he represents. But like I said, that's a matter for theological discussion among God's people. It's not a salvation issue. But to me, the imagery here is very, very clear. One wound is superficial, and the other is indeed mortal. So he's going to be destroyed. And so we see the beginning of the gospel story. The story of salvation, the story of the day of the Lord, the story that this day represents. It all begins there in this incredible thing that the Lord said to Adam and Eve and to the serpent there, a serpent. So, having said that, let's turn to Revelation chapter 10. In Revelation chapter 10 at verse 7. And this is a good place to begin for an educated audience. Now, I'm speaking to a long-established congregation of long-established Christians who are an educated people. We are a biblically literate church. We actually read the book. And because of that, we come on to this scenario here, beginning with chapter 7, with an understanding of what it portends, what it leads us to. We know that the Bible talks about, in the book of Revelation, seven trumpets. And when the seventh trump sounds, we know that that represents the Lord Jesus Christ returning. Here in verse 7 of chapter 10, in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery, the mysterion of God, should be finished. See, it's important to stop for a moment and think about that. We don't know it all. Paul said we only know in part. The mysterion of God has not yet been fully and totally revealed to us. Now, we know a great deal. I think you can make a good case for saying we may even know more than Paul and the others in his lifetime knew. Because, like I said, we've been looking through that glass now for 2,000 years. And we see a lot of things. Geopolitically, we see scriptures that have come true, prophecies that have come true. All of that gives clarity to us in ways that other generations have not had. Other generations lived in a time where certain scriptures could not possibly come true. There's virtually nothing in there that couldn't happen in our generation. Do you see my point? And so, we need to understand that we will understand it all as it begins to happen. You need to be very careful about reaching too far out in the prophetic scenario, because God can make all this happen in ways that don't compute for us yet. You follow me? We don't know everything yet. Paul, if Paul said we only know in part, then I'm not going to stand up here and pretend that I know it all. We don't know it all. The mysterion of God is still unfolding for us. And in the days of the seventh trump, the mysterion of God shall be finished. When we meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the air, the mysterion of God, there won't be any mystery for us anymore. Now we'll get the whole picture. We'll have HD TV, you know, high definition. We're going to get a very clear picture in that moment. That meeting with Jesus Christ is going to illuminate us and expand us in ways that words simply fail to convey. It's going to be a big time inspiration, to say the least. And we will understand. It'll all be clear. Paul even said that when that happens, all the pain and misery and suffering of our lives and human history is going to pale into insignificance, and it won't be worth mentioning anymore. And it'll simply go out of our memory at some point, out of human memory at least, of what we will experience and the glory that we will see and experience and be part of. The mysterion of God will be finished as he has declared to his servants, the prophets. It's all there. And that's important to consider. I wish that Sunday keeping preacher was here today. I have nothing but goodwill towards that gentleman. I wish he was here today. He needs to hear what I've got to say. The law of God is not done away. And Matthew 5:17 does indeed make that clear. Don't think that I came here to destroy the law. And I'm referencing that to also reference what he said in addition to that. I didn't come here to destroy the law or the prophets. Everything that's been prophesied is going to happen, just as he said it would. It hasn't been done away. And I would just love to be able to sit down with him and expound to him the fact that the Greek word there for law is the exact same word that if someone went in Greek wanted to talk about the law, if you spoke the Greek language, you'd be using the word that the Hebrews use for Torah. The Lord wasn't referencing the Ten Commandments there. That's a big misunderstanding in total. He's saying there in those scriptures, it's just what I referenced before, the sacrificial aspect of the law is filled full in Christ, but nothing else has been affected. It's all still in force. I came not to destroy the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. That is the precise, perfect translation. I didn't come to destroy that. I came to fill it full, to give you understanding of it, to make it spiritually connect with you, to make you understand what I'm talking about. That's why he goes on and gives us a litany of examples, including divorce. If you lust for a woman in your mind, you've already, it's not just the letter of the law. You can commit sin in your mind and in your heart. You didn't get that before. You didn't understand that before, you bunch of Pharisees. And so none of that's done away. The wisdom associated with the do's and don'ts in the Old Testament, that's not done away. All of the mores and values given to us in the Old Testament, none of them are done away. They're magnified in Christ. They're made visible through Christ. They're expounded to us through Christ. The only thing that's done away is the sacrificial aspect of it. His sacrifice supersedes and is superior to all sacrifices combined because he's God the Word, the source of life, all life. There's not enough sheep or bulls that have ever lived or ever shall live to equal his sacrifice. And that's the point. He fills that full, every bit of that full, and makes clear to us what all that represents. And that's why Paul and the others were able to say that salvation is there. The picture of Christ is there in the Old Testament. That's what he told Timothy. The plan of salvation is there revealed. If we didn't have the New Testament, God's Holy Spirit could still lead us to the knowledge of Jesus Christ with nothing more than what we call the Old Testament. The New Testament is an expounding, enlarging understanding of the Old Testament. It doesn't in any way replace it. It is a compendium to it. Through Jesus Christ, we can understand it. It enlightens the Old Testament. That's why Paul said, let all scripture, all proof, all doctrine, everything must come from what? From the scriptures you have learned as a child. What scriptures did Timothy learn as a child? The New Testament didn't exist yet for hundreds of years when he made that statement. The only Bible that they knew anything about. If you were talking to Paul about the New Testament, he'd have the deer in the headlights look. He wouldn't know what you're talking about. It didn't exist. It took a long, long time for God to bring together the writings of those individuals to coalesce into the document, the holy document now that we call the New Testament. The only scripture Paul referenced for us to get our doctrine from, to get correction from, to get reproof from, so that we would be truly furnished in all ways, is the Old Testament. Like I said, I'd love to be able to sit down with that very fine gentleman and talk about some of these things, and I'm disappointed that he's not here today. I thought he was going to be here. I understand he's a real fine fellow. Maybe he'll see this sermon. But this references, of course, the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you would, turn with me over to Revelation chapter 11, and let's look at verse 15. The seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, "The kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." When the seventh angel sounds, that's what happens. It's the beginning, as it were, of the kingdom of God. When Christ came preaching his ministry, when he started, he came preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. It's about the kingdom of God from cover to cover. It's one of those main story themes and threads of the Bible. The fact that he's going to return and establish the kingdom of God. We're not going to go to heaven. Heaven is going to come here in the person of Jesus Christ and the saints who meet him in the air, who will then land with him and turn this ugly, messed up planet into heaven on earth. That's the good news. That's the gospel message. And in that day, he's not going to just kind of like bounce off the atmosphere. And I'd like to be able to expound to all of us today and to that fine gentleman if he was here, that this doctrine that you believe in about a rapture to heaven is not theologically sound and it's not biblically founded and the word does not appear in Scripture, and it's only been in the last 200 years that that kind of preaching exists in any Christian writings and sermons. It's a recent doctrine, time-wise, in Christianity, just as the concept of speaking in tongues as it's practiced in the Pentecostal church is. 150 years ago, it was absolutely unknown in Christian theology. The recent doctrines. And that can be proven from someone who's willing to do the research. The records exist. The Azusa Street experience goes back in living memory for some people. And perhaps for their parents, when Pentecostalism, as it is now practiced, began. And the doctrine of the rapture, it's a French word, rapture, doesn't appear in the Scripture. There is a concept wherein we're going to meet him in the air, yes, but that's a far cry from what is being preached and portrayed. The Bible doesn't teach that we're going to heaven. Heaven is going to break out on earth. That's the reward of the saints, to be able to be with the Lord Jesus Christ and help the Lord Jesus Christ facilitate heaven on earth. That's what's going to happen. Because God is still in pursuit of Genesis 1:26, and in order to achieve that, he has to make this planet a habitable place for the creatures who will ultimately rise up to be in his image and likeness. God intends to have his way, and ultimately, somewhere down the line in that thousand-year period, man, I love to do this, I'm a ham, man is going to be the noble creature that God intended him to be in every way. Man will rise up to be what God intended him to be, because Jesus Christ and the saints who meet him in the air are going to heal humanity. The human genome is going to be cleaned up. There's not going to be any more precious little children born with terrible deformities. Tuberculosis is going to disappear. Infantile paralysis won't exist. There won't be any pedophiles. And guess what? There's not going to be any more abortions. And there's certainly not going to be something called gay marriage. The world is going to be changed. Jesus Christ is going to return, and he's going to land on planet Earth. And we're going to land with him. We're going to meet him in the air. There's nothing in here to indicate that his coming is going to be a two-step process wherein he comes in a secret meeting and takes the church away. No, the return of Jesus Christ is going to be the most public, spectacular thing that's ever happened in human history, the seminal moment of human history. There's not going to be anything secret about it. The scripture says every eye will see him. And when that trumpet's blown, it's going to be the quintessential sound of sounds. A sound so irresistible, it's going to wake the dead. Nothing secret about the return of Jesus Christ. He's going to come back in great power and majesty, and he's not going to come back to be abused or have his power and authority challenged or to be argued with or reasoned with. He's going to come back and give orders, and they will be obeyed. He's coming back not as a little baby or as a beaten, bedraggled, mistreated, spat upon, and beaten human being hanging on a cross. He's coming back as the Almighty God that he is. And he's coming back with full authority. All the power that exists in heaven and all the power that exists in earth. And that's inclusive. There is no more power. All the power that exists resides in Jesus Christ. He is the fullness of the Godhead, the scripture teaches us. In him all authority exists. Now he's coming back. And when he gets back here, big, big changes are going to happen. And the law will go forth from Zion. And it will change the earth. It will change the world. And the scripture tells us that in that day, his spirit will be poured out upon all flesh. We see the beginning of that prophecy, Joel's prophecy, that Peter expounded on the day of Pentecost. And it's going to be poured out like water pouring out. And we're going to be the vehicles by which that water pours out of us as the saviors along with him in the kingdom of God. We're going to effect great change. The law will go forth from Zion. And people will say, come, let us go forth. Let us go to Jerusalem. Let us go to Zion. Let us go to the house of the Lord, to the mountain of the eternal. Let us learn of his ways. Because Islam has failed us and brought us to disaster and ruin. Hinduism has brought us to disaster and ruin. Everything has brought us to ruin. Let us go and learn of his ways. And maybe we'll get us something to eat. And maybe we'll live. And maybe the earth will be cleaned up. And maybe our children will be healed. And that's exactly the scenario. And as time rolls along and the kingdom is established, the law goes forth, it will do its work. And the word of God will go out and change the world. And we're the ones that's going to make it happen with the Lord Jesus Christ. King of kings and Lord of lords. And we're the kings and lords that will effect that change. I'm going to be a king and a lord in the world tomorrow. It remains to be seen what my name will be or what your name will be. Even now, he's planning it. He's thinking about that based upon how I react, how I respond to his leading. He's figuring out a name for me that defines me to him. And it's a new name that I'm going to have and that you have. And it'll define me. It will define my authority and who I am and what I do and what my function is. Maybe I won't have any authority. Maybe I'll just be a doorman. That's okay too. But God's planning it all. And it is the ultimate fulfillment of the mysterion of God. There's a connectivity from God to you and me in this moment. And that connectivity is reinforced through his holy days. Let's think about them. Let's think about them. You're going to run out of tape. Think about the holy days and the panoramic picture that they paint for us. How blessed we are to have the holy days. You've got Passover, not Easter. Passover. One of the most ancient concepts in the mind of God, let alone his people. No, this is an ancient concept in the mind of God. Peter tells us that this started in God's mind, at the throne of God in past eternity, before the world was. Christ was already construed to be the fail-safe, the Lamb of God, we're told. Before man existed. And the Lord Jesus Christ came here and became indeed the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. You know, and years ago in my Bible, in John's writing upon that subject, he says, "Behold," when the Lord was coming to be baptized, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." You know what I wrote there? "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away Wayne's sin." Yeah. Under there, I underline that. Yeah. He takes away my. He is indeed the Lamb of God. And he came here for that purpose, to take away our sin, to cover it with his blood, and to keep it in play, even now. We're saved not just by his death, but by his life. He's my high priest. He's not just my Savior, he's my high priest. He's my mouthpiece at the throne. He's my advocate. He literally is my attorney, as it were, on my behalf and your behalf at the throne. He argues my case on an ongoing, continual basis before the throne. Because meathead that I am, I, on an ongoing basis, continue to miss the mark, as we all do. And I love to be, you know, to have the opportunity at the podium to stick it to preachers and ministers. Having come from a culture years ago, and some of you know what I'm talking about, when we all believed that the ministers could raise the dead and walk on water. No, they couldn't. Jesus Christ could. Peter did for a few seconds, you know. I can't walk on water. I don't have the gift of healing. Healing has happened at the end of my hands, but it wasn't an inherent gift. Preachers are made of clay, just like we all are. And we're all still dealing with our carnality. And when we meet Christ in the air, when he does return, the representations of this day, he'll still be the only one perfect in that meeting. The best human who's ever lived, other than him, will still be very, very flawed compared to him. It's only him. It's only through him, of him, for him, by him. You know? He really is the all in all. He really is the fail-safe. And that meeting is going to be so meaningful for us. It's going to be so drama-laden. There's going to be so much pathos in that meeting. There's going to be so much connectivity in that meeting. The light is going to shine through for us in that meeting. And it's going to change us. And as a result of that, this carnal, very unholy person, I'm glad my wife's not in the room anymore. I must have drove her out of here. But I'm not holy. Is anybody here holy? Will you be so bold in my face today to raise your hand and tell me that you're holy? But after that meeting, once we meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the air, it's not going to be metaphor. It's not going to be some analogous relationship of holiness. The scripture says, "Holy is he in that first resurrection. Upon such the second death will have no power, but they shall be priests and king priests, as it were, with the eternal, and reign with him 1,000 years. That's a sight more spectacular and meaningful than what is portrayed in traditional so-called Christian theology. The idea of souls winging their way to heaven to become angels. First class angel, second class angel, third class, I don't know. No. Angels are going to kneel to me. Angels are going to serve me. Angels are going to do deference to my very presence and to yours. Because we really are going to be the God children of our God Father. And they will be pleased and happy. Once the controversy is settled in the angelic realm, and they are completely satisfied, and all the things they desire to look into have been answered for them, and they will be, we will bring adjudication to all of that. We will judge them. We will bring finality to it. And they will acknowledge our sovereignty and our superiority. And there's already been a preview of that. When the man, Jesus Christ, because he did indeed become a man, the God-man, but he was fully human. And when he walked up onto that sea of glass, the risen Lord Jesus Christ, he represented something to the angels. And I'm sure they couldn't fall down low enough to acknowledge the sovereignty of man when that bedraggled, beaten man walked up there to the arms of his Father. And so it shall be when they serve us in eternity. And we're going to be able to do great things because of it. We're going to change this planet. And the spirit of the eternal, the knowledge of the eternal, will be covering the earth like the seas presently cover the earth. The low places will be made high, and the high places will be made low. Even the weather is going to change. Everything's going to change. The flora and the fauna is going to change. Peace is going to break out. Animals with an aggressive nature are going to be changed. Humans with an aggressive nature are going to be changed. We won't beat swords into swords anymore. We'll beat our swords into plowshares. There's not going to be a Sandhurst. There's not going to be a military academy. There's not going to be a West Point. A man won't learn war anymore. Peace is going to break out. Peace on earth. And we see that all of it is accomplished, of course, because of what Passover represents. And then we go to the days of unleavened bread. And what's that represent? Students of the Bible, what's it represent? And we talk about the leaven, and it's a good analogy, and you can prove that from Scripture. Paul goes into that and proves that. But we're told to get the leaven out of our homes. Anybody here do that this year? I mean, we're obliged to do it, to at least make the effort to do it, of course. I'm not suggesting we should put tape across doors and say, no entry to this room because it's been de-leavened. Our homes are places that provide shelter for us. I mean, we sleep there, we eat there, you know. But this is where we live, right here, between our ears and behind our eyes. This is our domicile. We live here. And this is where the leaven has to be out of there. You know, Christ won't live in a leaven-filled, cluttered-up house. And the leaven is representing our personality and our sin by the contrast that we've seen between pride and humility. You got to get the leaven out of here. That's what it's all about. And so it represents our change, our conversion. Christ said that John was the greatest among men born of women. For what reason? Because of his humility. Because he completely and totally acquiesced and made himself completely and utterly subservient to the Lord. When he had the esteem and the love and the prestige and the following and the adulation of the entire population, it says, all of Judea and all of Nazareth, all of the Galilee and all of Syria, everyone flocked to John. They idolized John. John had to continually say, I'm not Messiah. I'm preparing the way for Messiah. He could have declared himself Messiah. He could have declared himself king, and the crush of people would have overrun Herod and the Romans. But he didn't do that. He said, I must decrease so that he can increase. That's the story of our conversion. That's what it's all about. Wayne has to decrease. And he has a great deal, but there's still too much of him here. The same with all of us. We must decrease. Got to make room for Jesus Christ. The mind of Christ does not force its way in. You got to make room for it. Let the mind of Christ be here. Don't resist it. It's his way of thinking. Sanity, as I portrayed to you before, that spirit of power and love and soundness of mind, you know, it gets in there with our participation. It's a reciprocity with us. And it can change us. It's changed me. It's changed you. Will anyone here deny that your lives are changed and different now? God's dealing with you. You've heard Jesus Christ. He's dealing with you. You're not the same as you were. You know things now that you didn't know. There's been a profound change in you. You're a better person than you used to be. There's more of him now than there used to be. But you need more, just like I do. And we're participating in a scenario here that can provide that for us. And the holy days show us that over and over and over again. And then, of course, our conversion being represented by that, then what do we see? We see Pentecost. The 50th day. That's somewhat of a misnomer. Pentecost just means 50th or 50th day or count 50. It literally means count 50 or the count of 50. Pentecosti. But it's the feast of first fruits. Jesus Christ being the first of the first fruits. Turn with me in your Bibles over to 1 Corinthians. These are scriptures that usually are preached and read and preached at funerals, because there's very few scenarios where the gospel is not better preached than at a funeral, of course. But here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, let me begin at verse 20. But now is Christ risen from the dead. He is indeed risen from the dead. And as he rose from the dead, he became the first fruits of them that slept, of those that were indeed dead. And first fruits obviously implies what? Other fruit. If there's a first fruit, there must be a second and a third and so on. There's a chronology seen here. There's a plan seen here. And he's the first fruits. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. Yes, it was the first Adam who screwed it all up. And sin entered the human race and started doing its work, tearing things apart and destroying everything, causing death and pain and sickness and puke and vomit and hurt and tears in the Garden of Eden. Sin entered through the first Adam. And that's why the Lord Jesus Christ had to become, figuratively speaking, although literally, nevertheless, the second Adam. And that's how he's portrayed in the scripture. It was a man that screwed it up, and it had to be a man, totally 100% man, working on manpower that made it right. Because that is a controversial point with the angels, with Satan the devil. And I'm very confident that that was a big part of his strategy and a big part of the ways and means by which he deceived a third of the angels. And he still goes before the throne to accuse us and say we're not worthy and demand the death penalty for us. But Jesus Christ has proved him wrong. And that's why the Lord Jesus Christ, the second Adam, is able to stand there at the throne on my behalf and your behalf and say, Father, they are worthy. I proved it as one of them, utterly on their level and their terms. I proved it, Father. They're worthy. And that saves you and me. It keeps us saved, as it were. Pentecost, of course, is when God's Holy Spirit was poured out on His church. And that Holy Spirit, like I said, the leading of that Holy Spirit has changed us. Profound change has come to us. And we're still changing. It's a lifelong process. And I've heard preachers say that when they came up from the waters of baptism, or when you come up from the waters of baptism, you'll be converted. Well, no, you won't. Something will have started, but conversion is a lifelong process, and no one is a finished product in the moment that they come up out of that water. No one. And anyone who believes that needs to have a reexamination of their theology. It's a lifelong process. Repentance includes the contrition and the remorse that makes you want to be baptized. But repentance also means to change, to turn away from your sins. Again, the representation of the days of unleavened bread. You cannot walk along with the Lord Jesus Christ with your hand in His while you continue to drag the heavy weight, the burdensome load, the anchor of your sins along with you, with that other hand. Because you'll either let go of the sins or you'll let go of Jesus Christ. You'll get tired and let go of the Lord's hand. Now, it's a lifelong process. And then, of course, we come to what this day represents. And this day is the focal point. Three holy days passed and three yet to go. This is the seminal moment, the seminal point in the holy days. Three are passed and three are yet to go. The three that are passed are 100% about us, the first fruits. Everything that God has been doing from past eternity moves to that seminal moment when the Lord Jesus Christ returns and the church meets Him in the air. And the first three holy days are entirely about the first fruits. The last three holy days are about the empowerment that those who meet Him in the air receive in order to facilitate those other holy days. When the high priest would do his barley harvest waving of the sheaf to the Lord, it was an armload that was light enough, theoretically small enough and light enough that he could lift it to God. That's us, the first fruits. Precious few of us down through the ages. all of us from the time of Adam right up to the present time would be very precious few. Just a few of us. But on the other side, the seminal moment of Jesus Christ's return will set into motion the events that make possible the other side, the other three holy days, which is the big harvest, the harvest of billions. Because God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And the plan of salvation, in ways yet unforeseen by us, is going to apply to them as well. And we're going to help make it happen, that big harvest that's coming. And then, of course, what's the Lord going to do when he gets here? That's an important consideration, because he cannot do what he wants to do, and we cannot do what we've been ordained and fated to do until what happens? Somebody's got to be taken out of the picture. Someone's interference has to be negated, because he truly, really is the God of this world. He's absolutely in control, and his power is absolute and unchallenged and unchallengeable in this spirit realm, except when God decides to execute his own sovereignty. But for the most part, he's unchallenged. He is in control. He is the archon of the spirit realm here. Archon meaning enforcer, magistrate, prince, king, authority. He's in control of the spirit power on this planet. And his control is absolute. He has a throne. He has a crown. He's the God of this world. And there can only be one God of this world. There cannot be two competing gods of this world. He's a usurper. The throne is not his rightfully. He has usurped it. He has to be eliminated. There's only one rightful king, only one by lineal descent as well as spiritual descent king who has that right, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. He will return to receive his Father's kingdom, his heavenly Father and his father David. Satan the devil has to be bound. And where does that happen, brethren? This is a matter of theology here, and a matter of timing, because there are people who would eschew the holy days and say we don't need the holy days and they don't really have anything for us. And there are also people in our culture who believe that the Day of Atonement cannot possibly in any way refer to Satan the devil. Well, at some point, I think we can all logically agree, no matter what you believe, I think we'd all have to come to some point of conclusion at some time, that Satan the devil does get bound and thrown in that pit. When does that happen? It doesn't happen during those first three holy days. And when we come on the scene here of the last three holy days, what do we have? He's out of the picture. The timing has to be what? After the return of Jesus Christ, just common sense, logic, has to be after the return of Jesus Christ, because what do we know? Michael is going to bind him. Michael's a bad dude, as it were, in the vernacular. He knows how to fight. You know, I miss that sometimes. I'm too old to do it now, you know. But, ooh, I used to love it, you know. I was good at it, too. There's people walking around now with speed bumps on their head to this day that I put there, you know. But Michael is going to bind him and throw him in that pit. And he's going to be locked away. And see, that's what empowers the first fruits as being special. Our resurrection is special. It's superior. Because we have to overcome him while his all-inclusive, all-pervasive influence is here. And we have to deal with it. And that's why we will be the nobility in the family of God. God is choosing the jewels in the crown of humanity now, and we're going to be those jewels. There's a great reward for those in that first resurrection. And there will be great reward to us in the sense of accomplishment that we experience on that other side of his return too, as we then carry out his orders and his leadership and make it happen for other human beings. That's going to be a, you know, there's nothing better than helping somebody. We're going to be the helpers of their salvation. It's going to be a wonderful, spectacular time. The earth's going to be changed. Everything's going to be different. And the Day of Atonement, of course, has to represent the time when we acknowledge that we have indeed received the atonement. It's a done deal. Christ has done it. And all the references to our salvation are in the past tense. Preachers who used to preach otherwise, that you won't be saved until you're literally in the kingdom, that was wrong. I've said it so many times. Imperfect and flawed as I am, if I drop dead before I finish this sermon, I know this book, I know what it says. I'm going to meet Jesus Christ in the air because I'm saved. I'm a sinner saved by the grace of God. It really is about His grace. We are saved. It's a done deal in that respect. And He can keep me saved. My own weakness notwithstanding, His strength overcomes my weakness and yours. Yes, traditional Christianity stretches grace out of shape. But the church years ago forgot about grace. No. It's about grace. And with Satan the devil out of the way, that grace will be poured out in magnanimous, huge amounts to the world. The kingdom of God will be established as represented by the Feast of Tabernacles, which we'll be going to in a few days. Wonderful Feast of Tabernacles. When we have fellowship together like no other time of the year, don't we all look forward to it? Yeah. And we go there and we play act, as it were, the kingdom of God in many respects. And that's what it's all about, the wonderful fellowship and the sermons that we're going to hear, and the fellowship that we have, your spirit and my spirit being together, and being succor and comfort for each other, and putting our arms around each other and being with each other, you know. Because it's about tabernacling together with Jesus Christ and us in a oneness that transcends human understanding. John chapter 17. Father, I would that they be one with us as I am one with you, that they be one with us. I in you, Father, and they in us. I in you, you in me, and we in them, and they in us. That's what waits for us. A oneness that eclipses and transcends my ability to explain it, because, quite frankly, I don't understand it yet. It's part of the mysterion. And if I had the ability and the understanding, you couldn't receive it. It's part of the mysterion. We will not fully comprehend it until we're experientially full of it. And we look at it from the point of view of optonomahi, having fully comprehended and seen it in every way, emotionally, intellectually, intuitively, instinctively, in every kind of way. That's what waits for us. And the Day of Atonement, of course, is an essential. It has to happen for that kingdom to be established and all these wonderful things to be set into motion. And then, of course, ultimately and finally comes the great last day at the end of the feast, that eighth day. And it's highly significant that when the Lord Jesus Christ went to the temple to begin His ministry, He read from the book of Isaiah on the great last day and how He would set them free. The world will be set free. And at that point in time, these scriptures here that I'm about to read in 1 Corinthians 15 will really come true. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But, there's a sequence here. But every man in his own order, in his own sequence, as it were, Christ, the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at His coming. When does it happen? At His coming. Not at the moment of your death, but at the moment of Christ's return. And this idea that you consciously go to heaven or to hell at the moment of death is a pagan concept that is not supported in Scripture. Immortality in the Scripture refers only to God. God has immortality. And the point is that Jesus Christ came here to provide it for us. It is not automatically inherent to man nor to angels. It is a God quality. God owns it. He is it. And we can access it, we can get it, we can acquire it through Jesus Christ. But we're not born with it. If we were born with it, a huge big piece of Christian theology didn't need to happen. No. He provides it for us. We can access it through Jesus Christ. That's the point. At His return, we will receive it. But then listen to this, and this relates to the great last day, the great white throne judgment, which will ultimately be the most, the quintessential expression of our Father's mercy and compassion. He's not a destroying, condemning, hateful, mean God. He's love and light. There's no variableness of turning in Him. No shadow of thought or action. Then comes the end when He shall have delivered up the kingdom of God to God, even the Father, when He shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For He must reign till He hath put all enemies under His feet, and the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Yes, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to return, and the fall holy days portray the fact that this earth is going to be changed, and mankind is going to be changed, and it's going to be prepared. Man is going to be prepared, and the earth is going to be prepared for the arrival of God the Father. That's what it's all about, because God the Father from past eternity has been moving heaven and earth to that moment that is sweet and precious to Him, when He will ultimately and finally be with His children and His people. And now in conclusion, turn with me over to Revelation chapter 21. Chapter 21, I, John, speaking here. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Now, I don't know if that means a literal sea that you would go to the shores of this country and see, known as the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean. I don't know. Some have assumed that. I do not make that assumption. This very well could be a reference to the fact that the sea of glass has served its purpose and has now come here. You know, the New Jerusalem resides upon the sea of glass, and that may well be the reference that is mentioned there. And I tend to believe that's personally what it is, because there is going to be weather in the kingdom of God in the world tomorrow. Very clearly, the Bible makes that clear. There's going to be growing seasons. There's going to be weather. That requires oceans. That requires the interaction in the atmosphere with sunlight and oceans and all those kinds of things. You know, it's not going to be a supernatural world. It's going to be a real world. But at some point, a new heaven and a new earth is coming. And I know I'm stretching this out, but Peter at one point says that the elements are going to melt with a fervent heat. It's going to change. Yeah. And the Lord is quoted in Hebrews chapter 1. We're told that all of creation is going to be folded up like a scroll. It's going to be changed. Well, this is a validation of that and corroboration of that, coming at that from another angle. But it's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, either philosophically or literally. And both are accurate. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. The dwelling of God is with men. And He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. And God Himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And He that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And He said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And He said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Brethren, I submit to you that you have received a Feast of Trumpets sermon. God be with you.